Thank you. I'd like to welcome everybody here tonight. We'll start with the consent items. We have the minutes of the December 15th regular meeting, the certification of the December 15th executive session, and the minutes of the January 7th special meeting, and the minutes of the January 7th study session. Are there any additions or corrections?
I do need to add that, I don't know how I overlooked her, but on the minutes of the study session, that Christina was there also.
Okay.
I'll make that.
Anything else? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes with the addition that Sandy noted.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Don, second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries. 7-0. Financial report. Claims beginning with number 6106 for $49,931.24 for bond interest to claim 6267, $49 for a high ability conference mileage reimbursement. Sherry, your report.
Our fund report for 2014, our general fund ended up with a little over $800,000 in cash, so we're doing good. Our debt service fund ended up with $1,489,000. And why that's so high is you get an extra 6 months, you budget 18 months because your tax money might not come in time to get your payments. Our capital projects ended up with $295,434.25. Our transportation fund is also doing really well. It ended with $863,265. And our bus replacement ended up with $177,690.22.
Okay. Anybody have any questions? Anybody have any questions on claims? Okay, if not, I'll entertain a motion to accept the financial report, the fund report.
So moved.
Okay, a motion by Sandy.
I'll second.
Second. Lisa, any discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries, 7-0. Okay, moving on, student stakeholder focus. We have donations. Riddle student needs, Ted Denton, $50. RMS student needs, First Baptist Church, Wana Club, clothing and personal hygiene items. Rochester High School Project Lead the Way Robotics, Ryan and Sabrina Smiley, $150. RMS student needs, the Christian Guild of the Grace United Methodist Church, $106. RCSC Athletics, Rochester Athletic Boosters 500 Club, football, baseball, and boys basketball uniforms. Okay, do we have any other donations? Yeah. Any questions? Not a motion to approve the donations.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Brad, second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Okay, motion carried. Okay, out of state field trip from JAG. Brenda?
Thank you, Brenda.
Do I have to go up to the microphone?
No.
Okay.
What?
Oh, I don't want to be on the camera. I would like to open up a field trip for all the juniors and seniors of high school over spring break, primarily focusing on my JAG students, but to take them to the University of Northwestern Ohio, to technical school as well as a business school, they have a variety of majors that I think would appeal to a variety of students, so it's about 2.5 hours away.
Brenda does a great job with those students, and I applaud your interest in taking them to a vocational school, a trade school, and I know that that's one that a lot of our students have attended in the past. The concern and what we wanted the board to be aware of is transporting the kids across state lines. So we just needed to bring that to your attention, and knowing that Brenda will bring them all back, but that is the purpose mainly in making sure that you're aware of that.
About how many kids, Brenda?
I have told the university about 20 is what I'm expecting, 15 to 20.
And forgive me, what does JAG stand for?
Jobs for America's Graduates. I can fill you in more about it later on.
I just hired one this week.
Oh, did you?
One of your kids, yes.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Do you plan on exploring going to other schools too, or for right now, just the community?
Absolutely. We attended Manchester in the fall, as well as we went to Vincennes. And then Adam Strasser and I have also spoken about planning an Ancilla trip, also over spring break, and then looking at IUK, possibly in April. So.
I think prior to this, the only official trips were in eighth grade to Notre Dame, is that correct?
I can only speak for JAG, I guess. I don't know about college trips. I believe that the eighth graders still go to Notre Dame.
Yeah.
Oscar, so
this expands it.
Go ahead, Oscar.
This year they are not going to Notre Dame. They did go last year, but we're not going to Notre Dame this year.
But will you tell what each of the grade levels is doing so that they understand there's college at every level?
Yeah, the seventh grade goes to IUK. The sixth grade comes over here to the Ivy Tech building. And I am spacing where the eighth grade is going instead.
Purdue.
Yeah.
Does this involve a school bus, I assume, then? I'll take a bus and spend it in the hotel, and I'll have chaperones. And
It's
not. Oh, this is just not a
See how the color drain out of your face?
We'll leave about 9 o'clock in the morning and get back about 5 or 6. And that's giving us about a half hour leeway on either side. So, and the college is paying for lunch as well. So
they will have people there to guide you around?
Yes, actually, with the campus being as large as it is, the lady I spoke with said it would be best for her, them to come on the bus and the bus drive us around the campus as well, so the students can see all of the campus.
Are there any current Rochester graduates that you'll be able to meet up with? Do you know?
I've heard of a couple. I can't give them to you right now, but when I've been speaking with students, they want to go there because they're like, oh, my friend has gone there, or we've looked at this school. So I can research that and hit them up while we're there.
They're pretty well known for diesel mechanics and
yes, mechanics, technology, business. Like they have an accounting program, computers. There's a variety there.
Any questions? Okay, thank you. Entertain a motion then to allow the JAG field trip.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Jenny, second by Lisa. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay. Motion carried, 7-0. Okay, we have an overnight field trip, the FCCLA. Have someone talk about that?
Oscar or Adam, has Jenny Snyder talked to you about that? If not, I can share.
She has said that it's an annual trip that they take every year, but she has not given me a lot of details.
It's an annual trip that the FAC students take. They're able to work on projects. It's a culmination point. They go down, they display their projects. There's public speaking that goes with it. There are breakout conference sessions while they're there. Some are on leadership, some are more on that FACS area. Jenny has always done a wonderful job making sure that she has enough chaperones, as well as the program itself ensures additional help within the hotel and those types of things. But the students come back with a wonderful experience of having brought together a culmination of a project from Rochester schools and then being able to go down and show it at the state level. And then they're judged on their projects and given feedback on the presentations and those things.
Is it in Indianapolis?
Yes.
About how many kids?
I think it fluctuates. I don't know, Candy, if you remember, one year it seemed like there were 20 some, and then sometimes it drops down to 13 and 18 kids.
Probably 12.
This year 12. So it kind of fluctuates depending upon the program.
Okay, sounds like a good experience. Any other questions? Motion to approve that field trip?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion by Lisa and second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Motion carries 7-0.
Tom, would you repeat? I didn't get who. Sorry, that's okay. Who made the motion and second?
Motion by Lisa and second by Sandy.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Lucas and Adam, want to talk about that prom tickets?
All right, I'm apologizing for my attire. I'm coming from practice and going back. All right, this will be my third, Stacy and I, my wife, our third year doing prom. Fourth year doing it, my first year I did it with Christina Hughes. Currently, right now, the prom ticket price per ticket per student is $20 a ticket. We have prom at Manchester University. The room price has not risen, but all the other stuff that we do for the kids has. So I'm asking for an increase to $25 a ticket. And then those are the numbers from the area schools around us.
Lucas, do they still have an opportunity to offset that with fundraising, or is it a straight up?
It's a straight up fee. We used to do fundraising, and Janet can attest to this, is that it was based off of magazine sales. So 4 years ago when I helped do that, I'm like, oh, I'm going to be putting on a prom for $900. And we did that. So we phased that out and went to a straight prom ticket. So the what I found out in the 4 years is that the turnout has increased. Last year we had 220. So
if you get a chance to help chaperone, it's awesome.
It is.
It really is.
And Lucas has a thankless job. It is so difficult to put on and make sure you're ensuring the safety of the students and getting a location that's close enough to home that parents are comfortable, but far enough away that the students feel like they've traveled. And so I appreciate the hard work and effort that goes into that.
Been selling magazines for a long time. I sold magazines.
Which picture are you up there?
I sold magazines.
So no, I know that the favor, I know whenever I was in college, our favor was, like glasses that had etched, you know, the name of the theme of the prom and stuff. And, you know, as things change, they like t-shirts, and the t-shirts are now up to $8 a piece, and you calculate in 200 some kids, and so.
We kind of discussed this, I think it came up at study session, but probably not where maybe other people had heard. Sometimes we'll be out and about and people say, well, back when I was in school, we had it in the gym. Why can't we do that now?
There was a year when Hope Shelley and I were going to try to do it in the gym and the fire marshal. There were a lot of concerns with the fire marshal. And I can understand that. But to turn a gymnasium into a prom setting and not an athletic court, an athletic venue, was going to be very difficult. And then the fire retardant materials just raises the cost of what you're trying to do.
And if we had a venue in town, I would love to stay here, because you know it's one of those, Stacy and I, whenever we get back Sunday morning, and I know Mr. Weaver can attest to this, we don't sleep much until we start hearing from the kids on Facebook or Twitter or whatever that, you know, I'm home, I had a great time, because it worries us. But turning the gym into something that's cool and neat and having 200 kids show up to that. We asked 1 year, well, if we did it at the gym, they're like, I wouldn't come. So it's hard.
Okay.
I think one year we had it at Winfield Crossing, and it was a really nice downstairs. It just didn't provide the room that was needed. It just, it didn't. They were wonderful to work with. It just didn't work out.
It's too bad. I'm beyond dating myself, but we had prom at the Colonial Hotel, and you couldn't ask for anything better than that.
I love Manchester University. It is a great facility. With the water punch and the renting of the room, I can get everything for about $875. I can't beat it. It's, I think, 6 or 7 years old, the student union, with not just who we get for security, but then campus security deals with any issues we have, and it's safe. It puts them on a college campus.
It looks like the price that you're asking, the $25, is right in line with surrounding schools. Yeah.
And I want to keep it,
and I want to keep it
to where even, I mean, 60% free and reduced, I want to keep those kids to come because I know how much the dresses are. And
this may be a bit out of line, but Chloe, would $5 affect the kids that much? Will they still want to come? Is $5 okay with the kids?
Yeah, I don't think $5 is that big of a deal.
I mean, I trust Mr. Singles, but I want to hear it from the kids.
20 to 25, it's not going to affect people from going. It's not going to cause people not to go, I don't think.
You get a shirt with it too, so it's not a bad deal.
Do I get a shirt this year?
$25?
Yeah, I give them like, I donate my time they were going to pay me because I don't want to violate like anything ethically, so I think they give that to a needy student or something towards a prom cost or something.
No, he did donate his time, and the kids love him there. And
I don't know about that.
It's not a bad drive. Did it every day for a lot of
years. Yeah.
I should have asked this question before, but we're interested, but I'm just curious as to why a $25 item or a $5 increase is a board agenda item. Is there like some anticipation of pushback and you want the protection of the...
No.
You know,
I missed the deadline for whenever the high school, it's written into their handbook.
Oh,
because
okay.
We had a prom last year, and it was in May. It was already decided upon.
Okay, so this is a handbook issue that didn't make it in. That's why it's before us.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good question.
I move that we accept the increase to $25.
Okay.
I'll second
that. Okay. First by Lisa, and second by Sandy, to increase prom tickets to $25. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand, please. Okay, motion carries 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to information and analysis, the Safe School Emergency Preparedness Plan. Oscar, do you have some info for us?
Yeah, our school safety committee, our district-wide committee, we meet once a month. And as we, Dan Funk brought to our attention that basically, our emergency management plan was out of date, and so the district committee appointed Officer Doherty, myself, Dan, and Wendy Zent to go through our plan and update it. We had to update our crisis teams, make sure that we had our locations for if we do have to evacuate, God forbid, we got those places lined up and they're in our plan so everybody knows what's going on. One of the biggest changes is, you know, everybody used to know everybody and parents weren't divorced all the time and so forth, but if we have to evacuate to be able to set up an area to have parents come in, check in, and give their kid to the rightful parent or guardian who is in our student database system, and so we've got that in place there as well. So that's kind of what we did as a smaller committee of our district committee.
As far as the rest of it's pretty much the same then?
Yeah, most of it's the same. We had to update, you know, the building crisis teams to where it represented our new leadership and our admin team, and then some of the school nurses were different that we had to update there. Contact numbers, the bus drivers, we made sure we got that list updated as well. A lot of the changes were just wording. We want to empower our teachers to be able, if they see a dangerous situation, to be able to lock down the building or evacuate the students to get them away, where the language before was a lot of call your administrator before you do anything. And they don't have time, you know, to call the administrator if they want to keep our kids safe. And that's our top priority as a safety committee.
Okay. lot of times time's of the essence and you gotta do something right now.
Seconds matter.
Yeah.
The numbers, like, you know, the various possibilities and then there's numbered list as to what to do. Are those generally the order in which to do them? Is that what the lists are for?
And I think right at the beginning it says that in a crisis situation, common sense should take precedence.
Okay.
But that is kind of a general outline for, you know, we get new employees or you just want to refresh, you can kind of look through what maybe some of your initial steps could be if we do get in that situation.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Looks very thorough. I actually read through it today.
Yeah, up here.
Yeah.
Will this be made available to all the staff so they can refresh themselves, or how will that this information be given out?
That'll be to each building leader to make sure that their staffs have been informed of exactly what the expectations and guidelines are for their buildings.
Because if something happens, it'll probably be at the classroom level.
Oh, for sure.
More so than at the front office.
And that's why we wanted to empower the teachers, because mm-hmm. that was something that was not in the plan when we started.
Okay, any other questions on it?
Thank you, Oscar. I know there were a lot of time and effort and energy put into that. I know it's been a while since it's been updated.
Now, we won't need to vote on the revised plan or not to. Is that just...
I think it's adopted by the administration. Yeah, so it's just for your information. Right.
Thank you. Moving on, the faculty and staff focus, performance award administrative team.
I think it was just at the last meeting the board approved the performance award for teachers. We have a wonderful group of teachers and they were given the state funded award. And in that, a lot of the schools started looking at the administrative team, and I think great teachers are also supported by great administrators, and did not want to take from that funding for the teachers at all. Started working on what we had agreed upon with the teachers and looked at adapting that for last year's administrative team and really feel compelled. I think Oscar, that when we worked together last year, within the first 9 weeks he came into my office and said, I had no idea this is what happened in the office area. And I think that sometimes you're kind of naive to what goes on until you actually do the job and live the job. And I wanted to make sure that we recognize those administrators on that team, and underlying each of the administrators and directors is an underlying teacher contract, and they go through a very similar evaluation. Mirrors the McGrell evaluation, and they go through that every quarter. We meet on those, and so I just wanted to make sure that the administrative team was recognized. I'm hoping for the board approval for last year. We would follow the same memorandum that we did for the teachers.
I don't know if it's appropriate or not, Jenny. Can we say the number
sure.
for public? I'd just soon be transparent
sure.
and make yep. sure we tell everybody what.
Absolutely. The memorandum would, for those administrators last year who have left the district, they would not be entitled to anything. It would be those who are currently in the district. That boils down to six members at a cost in the general fund to $2,253.50.
And I know you're being, and I'm going to say this publicly as well, you're being very... what's the term I'm looking for here? You are not taking any credit for this whatsoever, because if I remember correctly, you were part of the administrative team last year as well, and you said you did not want the bonus. You were looking for it for your people, correct?
That's correct.
What is the figure if we were to do that for you as an administrator last year too?
Out of the general fund, $2,704.
I know you didn't want to say it, but I think it's important that you be recognized
team.
For that as well.
Thank you. I'm asking for the team.
And that number is the total impact, not the impact per person?
Correct, total impact, and that includes everything, all of the retirement, the taxes, everything that would go into it.
As we talked about in discussion before we vote on this, I would like to make clear, I think we as a board, or at least certainly some of us, and maybe that conversation needs to continue here, is we want you included, or I want you included, and they can speak for themselves, but want you included, that you were certainly, you are now, and certainly were an administrator, an important part of middle school.
Thank you.
When that happens, so I would like to vote on that with you included in that.
Thank you.
Because it is the 2013-14 school year.
Correct.
I would make, if you're ready for a motion.
Sure.
I would make a motion that we go with the seven-member administrative team award for $2,704, which includes Jana Vance, and also noting that she did request the six, but the board, or my motion is for the seven.
I second that.
Okay, then motion by Don, second by Brad, and discussion, all in favor? Tim?
Jana, would you want to give the names of the other six administrators who are involved?
Tammy McMahon would be a returning member. At the middle school, it would be Oscar would be a returning member. Jason Snyder continues to work within the district. Dan McCarthy, Loretta Deardorff, and Ryan Helt.
You know, before we do that, I did call on a student over there. I know that maybe this is online, Mr. President, if it is, please tell me so, but I was looking at Mr. Luton, and I wanted to know if he wanted to comment anything on that, or if you had any thoughts.
No, as the MOU read, I think that that's good. You know, I know that administration does a lot. They do a lot to help us, they do a lot to help the kids, and I have absolutely, you know, I think it's good that we're trying to do this as well. So,
I beg your pardon if that was out of line.
No, that's fine. Okay,
Tom, I would note, went to a school law session and they were talking about this, and a lot of schools took their administrators right out of the pool of funds for the teachers. Jana did not want to do that. Alex did not want her to do that, of course. And so, I think Rochester was doing a reasonably effective and appropriate thing here.
Good point. Okay, we've had a motion and a second and discussion anymore. All in favor, right hand, please. Motion carried, 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank all of you.
No, thank you.
Okay, the certified and classified bereavement leave. This dealt with the wording. Jana, if you could go over that.
Sure, there is a difference in our current policy with certified staff and classified staff as it deals with bereavement. And as we start to have concerns within the district and it comes to our attention, I think it's important that we try to rectify the best that we can those situations. And I think Brad said it best at one of our meetings, you know, you need to treat your people right. And so this is an effort to balance what we were writing. And I think that our hearts were in the right place. The wording just didn't get down on the paper correctly. So I am proposing that we change certified staff to mirror what is currently in our classified staff. All classified, thank you. It all goes into classified and to more closely mirror what is currently in the certified staff language. I apologize. Do I need to read that proposed change?
Just explain it.
It's just, the current policy at the time just allowed for 3 days for brother and sister, where the certified staff were getting 3 days for grandparents and grandchildren, father-in-law, mother-in-law, those immediate family members. And it just seemed like if we're going to treat all of our employees the same and it's meaningful enough for the people to miss at one level, it should be for everybody. Those families are their families, and we need to make sure that we're honoring that time together as a family. So I would just like that to more closely emulate, mirror what we have in our collective bargaining agreement with the teachers.
And I think it was probably just maybe overlooked the last time, the policy. And that's why we tried to review policy, and this was brought to our attention, and I'm glad it was.
Absolutely. I'm learning more and more, there's so much out there, and it's easy to overlook, and there's never any ill intent, you just lose track of some things. So I'm thankful for those people that are keeping their eyes and ears open for us.
Do we have any questions on?
Tom, this is a good time to inform the new members and remind the old members that school policy is traditionally handled with three readings. Bringing it up today as a first reading, the board has authority by unanimous consent to move it on to second and on to third reading. Traditionally, we do not go all three readings in one night because it gives people an opportunity to hear and discuss, but there are some things that they're no-brainers. So it's up to the board as to what you want to do, but the process would be this is the first reading, and it would go to second reading at the next meeting. That, and if, you know, if we were in a more formal arrangement, that's where the official amendments to the policy, if anybody wanted to change what's proposed, those amendments would go in. And then the third reading is when it's actually adopted, gives the board a chance to review it and to think about it. And you know, 80% of what you do is policy, so there is a little bit of a lag time to that, but it's designed into the system to make sure that these kinds of things theoretically should be caught the first time through, the second time through.
Mm-hmm. And gives public chance to comment if need be.
Right.
So I think we'll consider this first reading at this time.
After hearing Ted, I think we're doing it for the right reasons. It's a good thing for all, but I think it gives everybody a chance to look at it. And if they disagree with it, then they can give their opinions to us. Okay. All
right. So are you going to do first and second reading tonight and then third reading next month?
Well, I think we can just consider this first reading tonight. I don't think there's any, is there any reason to be
more expedient? Anybody passes away. I mean, yeah. We're waiting on a month, and right now there is that discrepancy, so.
We could, at the time we agreed to retroactive for the school year. Is that a possibility?
You could if the administration is comfortable with telling somebody, go ahead. But I think there's some family member that you get an hour or a half a day, I guess it is, instead of a full day for a funeral for a grandparent or an in-law or something like that. And so if the administration says you can risk it and the employee wants to do that, then then you can cover it. If they're afraid to risk it, then of course they can lose that benefit.
Okay. Any other comments?
Ted, is the exception that it's first, second reading together, or is the exception second, third reading together?
The rule is, well, the tradition is it's one reading at the first meeting, one reading at the second, one reading at the third. At any time, the board can move it to the next reading by unanimous consent.
Okay, all right.
So you can move it to second reading, and you can move it to third reading tonight if you wanted to. Or, so, you know, going to second reading tonight leaves you to have third reading, or leaving it as it is, you can do second and third reading next month. But it does give you some time.
Any other questions? What's the board's thought on the second, third, next meeting? I think so. Give enough time? Because we definitely want to have a month to get the word out. And, okay, that's what we'll do. Okay, Janet, would you like to talk about the membership to the UWVSSC?
It's the Upper Wabash Valley Superintendent's Council, Study Council, and it's been an excellent fit for me. They encourage every superintendent to join a study council, and I think it's in Huntington. I've been able to attend a couple of those meetings, and it's been a wonderful opportunity. In fact, this Wednesday, Adam Strasser and Alex Lute are going to attend one of those meetings. They're going to introduce us and update us on the A to F grading policy, the changes that are coming for the corporation. There's a lot of access points with retired superintendents and people who sit in all of those legislative meetings and then bring that information back to us once a month. And the chance to brainstorm together and sit with 30 other superintendents experiencing the same thing. It's just been a wonderful opportunity. There's a $500 per year fee to join that council, but then all of the meetings are free, your retreat is free, all of the mentorships that go with that are free as well. I've been to a couple of different study council members, and Linda can attest, I've come back from a couple of them and said, ooh, that wasn't, you know, that wasn't worth my day there, that wasn't worth my time there, but this has been a wonderful opportunity. It's been a good fit.
And this is just information, there's nothing to approve.
Right.
That's an annual membership?
Correct. And that's pretty standard, I think. Linda was doing a little bit of research, background check, and that's about the cost for most study councils.
Any other questions? Okay. Moving on to personnel report. Couple of additions here.
We should have two new ones that just came in. These are your two new ones.
Okay, there's a recommendation for Vanessa Gordon for an instructional assistant at the middle school. And the recommendation for Katie Wagner for open special education teaching assistant position at Riddle Elementary School. Then we have the reassignment of Rebecca Van Meter to RMS Cafeteria Manager from RMS Food Service Assistant. Hire Amy Freeman for the remainder of Kristen Murphy's maternity leave. The resignation of Megan Ringel from RHS Food Service Cashier. The resignation of Tricia Setterholm as a varsity girls soccer coach. The resignation of Haley Lehman as Columbia IA, and hiring of Jeff Hines as volunteer JV baseball coach. Any questions?
Hi, my name is
okay.
And I'm a member of the girls soccer team, and a couple of the younger girls asked me to come talk since I'm a senior and I was captain. I'm no longer part of the soccer team just because my last 4 years. But I just want to talk on behalf of Tricia. I don't want her to leave in a negative light. She has had such a strong impact on my life and my success as a soccer player and a student. Actually, tomorrow I'm going on a college visit to a Division I program for soccer, which is a really big deal for myself. And she's been one of the most important people in my success, so I'd like to give her that. I just want to say that on behalf of her, for her, our team has significantly increased. Sorry, my nerves are getting the best of me. But for my freshman year, we scored our first goal in sectionals, which is a major deal if you guys don't know that. And then junior year, we won our first sectional game. And over the course of time, she's helped me grow as a person and a player. I've had my share of, I guess, negative attitude, and she's helped me work through that. And this year I actually received an IHSAA sportsmanship letter, which is a really big deal because somebody that didn't know me personally or anything like that, he was a ref, gave me a recommendation. And from the beginning of the season to this to now, she's really helped me grow as a person and a player to be more confident and have a better outlook on life and be more positive to people, no matter how they treat me. And I've had coaches that have really cared for me and how I felt. Like Mr. Weaver, he's been there for me, especially through my knee injury. Like that was a really big struggle for me. When I actually had the surgery, she was the one who was talking me up, telling me, don't give up and keep playing, because I was actually thinking about quitting. And I just want to say that she's been such a big part of my life, and she's influenced so many players and has had such a positive impact on our team, and it's really sad to see her go.
Thank you.
I would like to talk on behalf of Trisha Setter Home as well. I've played many sports and have had many coaches, and I've never bonded with a coach, or I've seen so many players bond with a coach like they have Trisha Setter Home. She's just a great person and a great coach, and she's helped me through my life when I've really needed somebody, and I just really would hate to see her leave. I have a younger sister coming up to play soccer, and I wouldn't want any other coach but Trisha Setter Home to coach her. She's helped our team greatly. I mean, this year we had 7 seniors, more than any other team, because we love the sport and we love the coach, and it was amazing. And she's just a great person, and I really don't want to see her go.
Hey, I'm Natalia, and I'm Trisha, a foreign exchange student from Mexico. And well, I played soccer like from third to fourth grade, and then I quit it because I'm a figure skater, and I can like do 2 sports at the same time. And in Mexico, we have like full sports seasons. Like all the year, we do the same sport because we don't have like winter and like those kind of stuff. So I quit it, and then when I came here, I decided to play soccer again because there's no figure skating in this, like, here. So then, like, she made me fall in love with the sport again. Like, it's impressive how much I can say soccer is an amazing part of my life now, and it's going to be when I go back to Mexico, because she made me fall in love with the sport again. And after seeing how, like, I'm playing basketball, like, this season, and the teams work so different, because, like, the sport is so different, and I don't know, I just feel like Trisha makes every single player feel like fell in love with the sport, and she teaches how to play it. Like, I don't know, it's hard to explain. But it's going to be like really, really hard to like saw her leave, even if I'm going to be here next year. It's a program that I really care about because I've been part for the soccer team this year. And next year it's going to be like, I don't know, I'm a junior this year, and all my friends are going to be seniors next year. And it's going to be really sad seeing people like not playing just because Trisha's not going to be there. Because there's like a lot of girls that love Trisha, and she's not even like only the soccer coach. She's like more than that, because she takes time to bond with every single person. Even like if you are not a, like, if you have bad attitude, she's going to help you get like good attitude. And everything. She tries to help every single player in every single aspect, not only soccer. So that's what I mean.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay, we have before us the list, the personnel report. We need a motion to approve.
So moved.
A second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, right hand. Okay, motion carried 7-0. Okay, other business project update?
Right now we're working with Jim Swank and Terry Thornsberry, and meeting with the principals and Ryan Hout to start pushing forward again with the construction. Terry Thornsberry has requested that he come in and speak to the board, especially with new members on board, and answer any of those questions. A lot of what we're looking at for the next, to continue on with the project, is more behind the scenes things. I think this there's so much going on with the front entryways, and you can see people on the roofs, and you saw the changes in the high school gym, but what we're looking at now are some of those absolute necessities to make the building function. And Alex, I think, and Adam can attest to the heat and cooling issues at the high school, that they fluctuate so greatly, and so we're looking at some of those things that are controllers and handlers, and the way the buildings function behind the scenes, but Terry will be coming to speak to everybody and update everybody and kind of outline some of the original board's proposals and make sure that we are still prioritizing correctly. We're also working with Duke. They have been fantastic to work with, and I think that we found a location to put the new transformers in that it won't be disruptive to the high school. Also will help defray a little bit of that cost running the line into the school, so they've been wonderful to work with as well. So I anticipate Terry being at the next board meeting just to bring everybody up to date and to answer any questions the new members and those old members might have as well.
Be our next study session.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Jana, I was at a meeting, let's see, last week, and someone made mention of heating and cooling issues at the middle school.
There was, Oscar, do you want to talk? I know that there was a piece that went out. I'm not the mechanic, but it was a piece that had to be ordered to open and close the vents from inside and outside. And at one point, they got stuck with the air coming from outside in, which made the classrooms really cold. And we thought that we had that fixed. And then, lo and behold, they shut those down, and now it broke again. So Jim was ordering the part, and my understanding is it's...
As of Friday, it was fixed. Today, the classrooms were at a normal temperature, but last week we did have 3 days where it could have been 20 degrees, so I told our teachers to enjoy the heat instead of the cold that it could have been, because the damper was stuck shut instead of stuck open. I think we were blessed that it happened that way instead of that way.
I think it's been stuck both ways in the last 10 days, 15 days, so it's finally fixed and going.
Okay, that's good. Any other business?
No. Thank you to Sandy Tyler and our three on the crew. Jim, I'm not sure who else was helping you.
Where's Jim? Where's Barbie? I don't know. Bob and...
Bob Reed, Brian Stockberger?
Yeah.
Helped hang the pictures. I know it's been Sandy's goal for quite some time, so thank you for getting that done. Just a heads up, you know, even though it felt like spring today and the weather was fantastic, we did use some of those built-in school days, snow days, so we'll be looking at attending school on February 16th, May 1st, and right now June 1st and 2nd. Hoping that that's going to be all for the weather. We'll wait and see. Brad told me this week's storm is kind of dissipated, so we're thinking we've got a good week ahead of us weather-wise.
And hopefully then, I only have to be right 30% of the time.
And then finally, Tammy McMahon contacted me, and Justin Masterson is a Boston Red Sox pitcher, and he has agreed to come in and kick off at Columbia their readathon that's going to take place. Jill Weaver has been an integral part in organizing that and getting him here, but Justin Masterson from the Boston Red Sox will be here to help kick off that readathon. Mm-hmm. So I will give you more information as we move forward with that.
Who was it? Who's the pitcher?
Justin.
Justin Masterson.
He's a pitcher.
Masterson.
Uh-huh. He used to be with Cleveland, and he's a family friend of Jill Weaver.
Cool.
So she's had him in a couple of times when she was teaching in the classroom, but now it looks like it'll be a school-wide thing.
A school-wide. Trying to engage the Columbia kids in reading.
Sounds great. Before we adjourn, I'd like to introduce our new board members that made it through their first meeting. Steve Schaller, Brad Weaver, and Jenny. Would you like to each of you tell a little bit about yourselves?
About yourself? Sure, Steve. I'm Jenny Smith, and I have three children in the Rochester school system. I've lived here my whole life, and I'm looking forward to being part of the school board and part of the process that so many people have done such a great job paving the way for us.
Thank you for not aging me.
And my senior year was Janice first.
Brad Weaver, married to Carrie, three children in each of the three schools. Can't wait to serve, trying to learn. There's a lot to learn. Always open, want you to come talk to me. We may not always agree, and you may not always like my answer, but I always want to hear your opinion. So thank you very much, and can't wait to get started.
Thank you, Brad. My name's Steve Schaller, and my wife was on the school board about 6 years ago, so we had a little taste of what it's like. So I in reference to everybody else, I really did know what I was getting into. But I think it's an important job and that you need to step up and take care of your kids. And so I've got two in high school now. And, you know, they're all our kids, so we look out for everybody. And I'm glad to be able to contribute.
Yeah, thank you, guys. Well, this time we're going to adjourn our regular meeting and convene our Board of Finance meeting. This is the meeting we have to have each year. It doesn't take that long. But one of the first orders of business is to appoint, or not appoint, but to vote on officers. And so as to get started here, I'll entertain a motion to for a president of the Finance Committee.
I nominate Brad Weaver for president.
And I'll second.
Motion by Steve, second by Lisa, for Brad Weaver as president of the Finance Committee. All in favor, right hand, please.
Abstaining.
And Brad abstaining, six.
I'm abstaining. I'm willing to serve and absolutely flattered, but in the interest of conflict interest, I will abstain.
Okay, this time.
I know. It didn't pay anything, that's for sure.
This time we'll turn the meeting over to Brad as a new president of the, and continue on with the election of the.
Well, I'm going to turn over to somebody that's much old. I'd like to nominate Steve as secretary for the Finance Board then, if that's
the way.
Well, but well, you're taking over.
Oh.
It's your job now.
So you had a motion or a nomination. I made a motion for a nomination for secretary for the Finance Board, is that correct?
So moved.
Second.
And that would be Steve Schauer, correct?
If that's what
was that what your motion is saying?
That was my second.
Well, that is clear.
So a motion by Lisa, a second by Don. Please signify by raising your right hand if you're in favor of Steve Schauer being elected secretary for the Finance Board. And I take over from here as well, then I'm going to turn it over to someone that's much smarter than me, and I will leave it to Sherry from here to go over those things with the board. I saw her today in shorts and a sweatshirt. The only thing she said was you're wearing shorts.
This is our year-end investments. Interest we earned was $2,377.60. We had no fees from our bank, which is really good. We have two bank accounts, a sweep account, where all your money sweeps at night to try to get more interest. That's $4,795,413.13. And our other account, main account accounts payable, but always has $2,500 in there, so you have enough money to cover while the rest of the money is sweeping back and forth through the federal government. We have two scholarship CDs. One is $4,536.60, and one's $1,129.86. We had a lockbox at Wells Fargo. We paid $110 last year for it. Me and Linda and Sandy went last Friday to see what was in our box, and it was just like deeds and paperwork, so we closed them out and brought them back and put them in our safe at the admin building, so we won't have that next year. Our self-insurance fund, we have $227,506.73. So that's good. Last year it closed in a negative, so we're positive. Repair and replacement fund has been paid back 100%. So that's good. And then our current balances, I just listed them again as we went over in our last meeting. Our general fund has $863,834.98. Our debt service has $1,489,635.24. Our capital projects has $295,434.25. Our transportation fund has $863,265. And our bus replacement has $177,690.22.
Sherry, something we talked about today, if we could relay the board, in February, was you said February 1st, we'll be gaining interest on another $1 million, is that correct?
And yes, that come in about? February, because with banks, you have to wait until checks clear and things happen. Sweep accounts were a long time ago, so we're going to go away with that. And how it was set up here was in the back. And they would be moving, like, if we had a payroll, they would move the money or not. So we have $1 million that was not getting interest in that process. So February 1st, they'll break out into their own separate accounts so they can be tracked, and then we'll get interest on all our money. And then we should raise our interest amount.
How long was $1 million not getting interest?
I would say probably
it was that way for Sheila, I think it was that way for John. So I would say quite a long time.
Okay. Sherry has done a wonderful job. She's already met with the administrative team, and we're starting to organize those, work on budgets, making sure that the building leaders and directors know exactly where they stand and where that money is. She's come into, we all know, the rotation of a couple of business managers, and is taking that on and is helping us align our finances and making sure building leaders, it's so important that the building leaders and directors know exactly where they are to help the overall financial. And now she's getting ready for her first audit here at Rochester, and so she has taken a lot on, and she's been putting in a lot of hours and really helping us through some difficult times. So I appreciate all of the hard work and effort and what she's doing to help improve our financial situation.
Thank you. Lisa, please. Any comments from the public on the report from our treasurer? And then yes, ma'am.
Do we have an interest rate, or did that vary?
Your interest rate is like 0.002. I mean, it's
okay. What is it specifically? Do you know?
It's 0.25. It's very low.
Okay. Thank you.
Sherry, you're pretty comfortable with our self-insurance fund, and
yeah, we're doing okay in there.
Yeah, and CDs are right now.
And we're going to start making regular deposits into the self-insurance. Before, it kind of fluctuated back and forth when those deposits were made, but Sherry and I are both wanting to make sure that each month that we're creating a budget where every month we know how much needs to be set aside to make sure that we're covered, instead of kind of fluctuating back and forth. So those will be monthly payments that we will start making. I think it's going to be easier budget-wise to track and follow.
Well, sure, we all have to live in our households as with an account, I think. That's only fair to do.
Absolutely.
As this is my first meeting, Mr. Wagner, where would I go from here?
You would invite a motion to receive the report.
I'm inviting motions to receive the report.
So moved.
Second. Lisa moved to receive those. Sandy seconded. Please signify by raising your right hand if you agree to take the reports as given. Passes 7-0.
Declares adjourned.
We are adjourned for the Board of Finance meeting. Next job, to ask these questions again.
Thanks, everybody, for coming.
Yes, thank you for coming.
Grab a piece of-